Good evening, everybody. Tonight, as our chairman has announced, our topic is on the subject of intelligent design, but perhaps more specifically on the question of Bible evidence for intelligent design. And as you can see from the screen, we're going to look at something that begins, as far as the Bible is concerned, with the very first verse of the Bible and the very first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis. And from there, we're going to traverse some biblical thinking that might add to our knowledge on the intelligent design argument. I suppose what we could really say about our seminar tonight is that this is really about the question of origin. It's all really about how everything started, where and how it all began. And the reality is that there are only two fundamental world views. And those views, as you probably know, are firstly that things began and that things came into existence by means of what we might describe as random spontaneous generation. And those are not exaggerated words, they are the very scientific words that are used to describe the process of naturalistic methodology which science uses. And the other worldview suggests that, in fact, everything began because of intelligent, supernatural creation. There's really only these two options. Now, we need to make clear tonight that as Christadelphians, we don't profess to be scientists. And although we're going to make reference tonight to some scientific laws and some scientific thinking, we're not here to suggest that we have scientific expertise. But we do claim to be Bible scholars. And what we hope to set before you tonight is that, in fact, what the Bible sets forth is much more scholarly and far more scientific than most people might imagine once you begin to look deeply and properly. So let's start with the scientific view, shall we, as to what happened in the beginning. And effectively what science says is this, that there were some critical ingredients needed in order for everything to begin. And those ingredients were as follows. There needed to be time. Time is a dimension in which certain things occur. It's one of the ingredients that scientists believe both is and was necessary for the bringing forth of all things. And not only time, but energy. And not only energy, but space. And not only space, but matter. Here are the four critical ingredients that science says needed to be included in terms of the scientific concept of beginning. And if we were to ask how those things were then somehow co-joined together, we're introduced to what's known as the theory of the Big Bang. Now, this particular textbook quotation is a few years out of date, but I think substantially is the same in terms of still what's being taught today, with one exception. This is a quotation from a very common scientific textbook put out by a company called Prentice and Hall, issue one pretty much every year. It's a very common science, general science textbook. And what that says, as you can read there, is that most astronomers believe that about 18 to 20 billion years ago, all the matter on the universe was concentrated into one very dense, very hot region that may have been smaller than a period on this page. Of course, by period, what they mean is a full stop. So what they're suggesting is that the whole of the universe at that point was no bigger than that dot on the screen, perhaps even smaller, probably smaller than a full stop on the piece of paper in your Bible in front of you, which we're going to turn up shortly. And that from there, for some unknown reason, that region exploded. The explosion is called the Big Bang, and one result of the Big Bang was the formation of galaxies all racing away from each other. And so this is the scientific thesis of how really, if you like, the universe itself began. And I want you to notice some critical things here which are intrinsic to this idea. Firstly, it is uncontrolled. You cannot have controlled explosions. Secondly, it is non-intelligent. There is no rationality behind the explosion. And lastly, it is random. And I want you to remember those words because, well, I think they become critical in the story that unfolds. Now, let's open our Bibles, shall we, and see what the Bible says in terms of the Bible story of how it all began. Well, we've got to start in Genesis chapter 1, so let's come there and we'll piece together just three passages in order to understand the critical idea that I think the Bible presents concerning the biblical thesis of beginning. And this is what the Bible says. The Bible says, verse 1 of Genesis chapter 1, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Now the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, let there be light, and there was light." And so we have the notion in the book of Genesis that God intervened in some way to bring about a creative act, whoever or whatever God might be. And so Genesis starts us on a journey through the Bible, which begins with this thesis that it wasn't uncontrolled, and it wasn't random, and it wasn't non-intelligent. It was, in fact, the operation of God. Now, I'd like you to come to the middle of the Bible, into the book of Proverbs, chapter 8. Because Proverbs 8 adds, I think, a very interesting additional piece of information. And it's key to the word beginning. Do you notice that critical word there? In the beginning. Because this is a question, you see, about beginnings. In Proverbs chapter 8, a poetical book, and certainly a poetical chapter, it says in verse 1 of Proverbs 8, it says, "Doth not wisdom cry, and understanding put forth her voice?" Now, wisdom isn't really a woman, but she's being personified here. But I want you to notice what Proverbs 8 goes on to say about wisdom, commencing from verse 22. It says, "The Lord possessed me, wisdom, in the beginning of his way, before his works of old. I was set up from everlasting, from the beginning, or ever the earth was. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no fountains abounding with water, before the mountains were settled, before the hills was I brought forth. While as yet he had not made the earth, nor the fields, nor the highest part of the dust of the world. When he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he set a compass upon the face of the earth, when he established the clouds above, when he strengthened the fountains of the deep, when he gave to the sea his decree that the waters should not pass his commandment, when he appointed the foundations of the earth, then I was by him as one brought up with him. And I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him." Now, you see what the book of Proverbs tells us, albeit in poetical form. See, what the book of Proverbs is really saying is that before the universe was created, God's wisdom was already present. So intrinsic to whatever happened at the beginning of time, says Proverbs, it involved the wisdom of God. Now that word wisdom in Proverbs 8 is the most common Hebrew word in the Old Testament to describe intelligence. That's what that word means. It was there, says Proverbs, before God did anything. Now come to the New Testament and to the Gospel of John chapter 1. Do you remember what John 1 says? It's sort of similar, really, isn't it? Remarkably similar to what Proverbs 8 says. And the key phrase that links these three passages together is, well, why John chapter 1 verse 1 says, in the beginning. In the beginning God created, Genesis 1. In the beginning he possessed wisdom, Proverbs 8. In the beginning was the Word, John 1. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and all things were made by him, or it, the Word, and without it was not anything made that was made. So the Word was intrinsic to all that happened as far as the beginning of time, says John chapter 1. And some of you may know that the word Word here in John chapter 1, or the word Logos or Logos, means not just the spoken word, but all the reasoning, all the thinking, all the mental faculty, all the intelligence that stands behind the thinking. So John 1 and Proverbs 8 and Genesis 1 all agree that in the beginning, well, you see what the Bible's really saying. What the Bible's saying is in the beginning was intelligence. That's the Bible's thesis of how it all began. Science says uncontrolled, non-intelligent, random. The Bible says intelligence began everything. That's the biblical theory of the origin of all things. And it leads to certain consequences, you see, which we will find by and by are I think, vitally important concerning our worldview. And that passage in Genesis, which we won't turn back to just for the moment, but it's perhaps more interesting than you think, really, isn't it? Because, you see, Genesis said, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And we've just discovered that that involved his intelligence. But actually, when you think about it, in the beginning is actually a reference to time. And God creating is a reference to energy. And the heavens is a reference to space. And the earth is a reference to matter. And we suddenly find that there, in the very first verse of the Bible, are all the critical ingredients that scientists say is necessary for their theorem of the beginning or origin of all things. But it's in the Bible already. And in fact, there's something more than that, isn't there? Because I suppose what we should really think about is that there is one more thing, says Genesis, isn't there? Is that God was in the middle of all that. And for purposes of what Genesis is suggesting, the substratum that binds all together is intelligence. Oh yes, right from the beginning, says the Bible, that's how it all began. Now, if you come to the Gospel of Matthew, we're told in Matthew's Gospel that the Lord Jesus Christ believed in the events of Genesis. And I suppose the reason why it's important to just draw attention to that on our way through the Bible, well, you see what it says in Matthew 19. It says in verse 3, the Pharisees also came unto him, tempting him, and saying unto him, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife for every cause? And he answered and said unto them, have you not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female? He which made them at the beginning made them male and female. There's our key phrase again. At the beginning. So you see, the Lord Jesus Christ believed in the Genesis record of the beginning or the origin of all things. He believed it was true. He quotes it. He refers to it. So anyone who's a Christian can't then take up a scientific view of the origin of life and pretend to be a follower of Christ. Christ says he agrees with the Genesis record of how everything began. And all true Bible believers do agree with that Genesis record. Well, that brings us to Acts chapter 17, which was our reading for tonight. And of course, Acts 17, we're just going to take as a helpful template for some of the comments that we will make, because, well, because this was a very interesting speech that the apostle gave to people that had very similar atheistic inclinations to many scientists today. So Paul, on this occasion, was not preaching to a Jewish audience, so he's not going to refer to a complex cascade of scriptural allusions, although we do believe there are some key scriptures at the back of what he says, but he's certainly speaking to an audience who were atheistic, in common with the world that we live in today. So Acts 17 verse 22 says, Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, "Ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things ye are too superstitious." There's a little bit of doubt about what the phrase means in the Greek, but perhaps the phrase that ye are very religious might be a more acceptable alternative. I don't think he was being necessarily derogatory, but he was certainly saying you're a very superstitious, you're a very religious lot because I can see all the gods that you worship. In fact, he says, you're so religious that, well, he says, I found an inscription to the God that no one knows anything about, the unknown God. Well, he says that the funny thing is, I do know something about that one. And he that you therefore ignorantly worship, him, verse 23, he says, him, the unknown God, I declare unto you. And so now he's going to make his declaration of what he believes. And in essence, what he's going to do is give a lecture about origin. And you notice what he says. Verse 24, God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things. It's interesting, you know, because at the back of what Paul says on this occasion in what's called the court of the Areopagites is an argument about what we might describe as contingent and necessary beings. It was a well-known argument of the day. And basically it goes something like this. It says that any finite or contingent being, and contingent in this context means depending on someone else for origin or existence, every contingent being has a cause. And you can't have a causal loop. In other words, you can't have a series of causes that turn around and loop back on themselves because you'd never get to the end of the cause. It's sort of like a self-defeating idea. A contingent being that depends upon another contingent being that you can't put that into a loop and have it as an everlasting loop because you've never answered the problem. And you also can't have a causal chain of infinite length. You can't have a cause preceded by a cause preceded by a cause that goes on endlessly because you never get to the end of the cause. You never answer the question. So the conclusion was that there must be a first cause, an uncaused cause, at the start of the whole story. And it was a common mode of thinking of the time. Or if I put it another way, contingent beings are insufficient to account for the existence of contingent beings. And therefore, there must exist a necessary being whose non-existence is an impossibility and from which the existence of all contingent beings is derived. Now, I know that's a bit wordy, but can you see that in Acts 17, verse 24? God made the world, so he's the necessary being. And he's the Lord of heaven and earth, because, well, that's what Genesis said. He created heaven and earth. He's the uncaused cause of everything else in both heaven and earth. And if he's the necessary being, then, well, what's man? Well, man's the contingent being that depends upon God as the necessary being. God is necessary. Mankind is contingent, says Paul. And because God is necessary and not contingent, it must be obvious that he doesn't need anything. And that's what verse 25 says. He's neither worshipped with men's head as though he needeth anything. Necessary beings don't need anything from anybody else. They caused it. They don't need it. God must be innately self-sufficient, and any suggestions that there be a limiting of his power in any way is demonstrably wrong if he's the uncaused cause of all things. In fact, what Paul is suggesting is that the whole mindset of most human beings is wrong. What you need to understand, says Paul, is that he doesn't need you. You need him. He's the necessary being. You depend upon him. He doesn't need anything. You do. Now think about this as an explanation, another thought as an explanation in terms of what Paul is really saying here. And you'll notice that I'm deliberately moving into certain scientific laws, because that's really what we're dealing with tonight. We're dealing with the challenge of what the Bible plainly says when it rubs up against apparent scientific law and scientific thinking. Well, here's another law. It's known as the law of causality. The law of causality says this. By the way, you'll realize that there is a distinction, isn't there, between a law and a theory. A theory is an hypothesis that's been postulated, but which has never been empirically proven beyond doubt, so it remains a theory. A law has been evidenced by so many experimental proofs and empirical evidence that is deemed to be an operative law at all times and in every condition. This is the law of causality. It's not a theory. And basically, it's the law of cause and effect. And what it says is that every material effect must have an adequate antecedent or simultaneous cause. And in the realm of physics, it expresses the principle that an event cannot precede its cause. The key word in the law of cause and effect is this one here, adequate. There has to be an adequate cause that explains the effect that follows. Well, this is what Walter Space said, professor of philosophy from Princeton, said. Every student of logic knows that this is the ultimate canon of the sciences, the foundation of them all. If we did not believe the truth of causation, namely, everything which has a beginning has a cause, and that in the same circumstances, the same things invariably happen. If we didn't believe that, he says, all sciences would at once crumble to dust. The law of cause and effect is intrinsic to scientific thinking, he says. Now think about what Paul is talking about here in Acts chapter 17. He's talking about the creation of the universe, of heaven and earth. So what cause might adequately explain the effect of the universe coming into existence? What cause is big enough to be an adequate explanation of the existence of the universe? Now you see, the Big Bang theory postulates an uncontrolled explosion of stuff that somehow was already there. It never says how it got there, which is part of the problem of the Big Bang theory, because it doesn't actually answer the problem of how it all began. It says when it all began, it was very small, which doesn't really explain how it all began. Now, you see, that idea, how would you describe that as the law of cause and effect in play as an answer to the grandeur of the universe coming into existence, an uncontrolled explosion from a full stop? The law of cause and effect says there must be an adequate antecedent explanation. Paul says there is only one satisfactory argument that could even be considered that's adequate to the greatness of the universe, and that is the almighty power of God himself, who alone has the intrinsic power as the necessary uncaused cause to make all of those things be brought into effect. Only the existence of a God, says Paul, is adequate in terms of the law of causality. Do you notice what he says, what Paul says in Acts 17, verse 25? He says, God's not worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, seeing he gives to all life and breath and all things. Oh, now that's interesting. He gives life. Did you notice that key phrase? God's life is what Paul says. Now, you see, that conforms to a known law. It's the law of biogenesis. The law of biogenesis was brought into being really by the research of Louis Pasteur. Because at the time of Louis Pasteur, there were people that believed that things could spontaneously generate out of nothing. That life could come from non-life. And the research of Louis Pasteur came to a conclusion that says that life does not arise from inanimate material, but rather omne vivum ex vivo. All life is from life. It's a scientific law. All life is from life. And a scientist that followed shortly afterwards, Rudolf Virchow, added another truth in his study of the binary multiplication of cells. He said, omnis cellula est cellula, all cells are from cells. Now that might sound pretty simple, but it's absolutely profound. See, this is a scientific law. It says that all life comes from life. All cells come from cells. Paul says, God gave life because he is the source of life within himself. So actually what Paul says is consistent with the law of biogenesis. And as another writer said, Professor Simpson from the University of Arizona, there is no serious doubt that biogenesis is the rule, that life comes only from other life, that a cell, the unit of life, is always and exclusively the product or offspring of another cell. Well, that's what Paul says. He says life itself must have come from a source that could give life, not from something that was non-life, not from something that was inanimate. So what is the scientific postulate now in terms of how life came into being? Not the universe, but life thereafter. Well, the suggestion is spontaneous generation. And the interesting thing is that what they're really postulating is life from non-life in direct violation of the law of biogenesis. This is a quote from a very famous man. I'll put the whole thing on the board. George Wald was the professor of biology at Harvard University. Perhaps of greater interest is he was actually a Nobel laureate. And this is what he said. So the reasonable view was to believe spontaneous generation, because the only alternative was to believe in a single primary act of supernatural creation. There's no third position, he says, which is what we said at the start. There's no third position. You either believe in spontaneous generation, he says, or you believe in supernatural creation. And so for that reason, many scientists more than a century ago chose to believe spontaneous generation as a, notice this key word, as a philosophical necessity. Not a scientific one, a philosophical one. They had to believe in spontaneous generation because philosophically, they could not accept a supernatural creation which meant a supernatural creator. And so George Wald is famous for this phrase. One has only to contemplate the magnitude of this task to conceive that the spontaneous generation of a living organism is impossible. Yet here we are, I believe, as a result of spontaneous generation. Nobel laureate. I can promise you that that is not an example of scientific reasoning. It is an example of total cognitive bias, of utterly, purely subjective opinion. There's no science in that. There's a man with a preconceived idea that cannot accept the alternative. So even though spontaneous generation is impossible and in violation of the law of biogenesis, he says, this is how we came to be. I can't see anything else. It's got to be this. Interesting, isn't it? You see, what we really find is that scientists are no more impartial in their examination of the problems of life than anybody else on the planet once they've fixed their views. Now, Professor Vole wrote that in the 1950s, and the trouble is life's become a lot more complex since that time, because what he didn't know about, what he didn't know would come about, was the extraordinary complexity of life at the biomolecular level, which has all been discovered since he said what he said. Now, I'm not going to put this up as a slide, but you'll know. You will have all heard of the marvel of DNA. DNA sits inside every cell, as you know. Every cell comes from another cell. Every cell has 46 chromosomes, and it's got a little piece of DNA. It's like a little double helix that winds around itself, as you'll probably know. Do you know that inside every cell, know how long the DNA is? The DNA inside a single cell is 2 meters long, if you were to unravel it. It's that tightly packed. It's 2 meters of DNA. And within that 2 meters of DNA, there are 3 billion subunits, which are the fundamental bases of A, T, C, and G within the DNA helix that actually is the key to life. And out of those four things, there are 30,000 genes that are set up for coding proteins for the operation of life, all packed inside one single cell, just inside the DNA molecule inside that cell. 30 billion units for coding life. In terms of the code that's written in that DNA molecule inside one single cell, well, look, this is my Bible here. You can see the size of it. Imagine page after page of densely written coding, and now imagine that the coding for one cell is 350 Bibles long. One cell. And that coding's got to be exactly right. And so what's actually needed is for DNA replication is a code language, a code structure, a transcriber, and an error correction program that goes through DNA and keeps correcting any mistakes that might occur within that structure. It's absolutely phenomenal. And it introduces us to this interesting problem. It's called the problem of complex specified information. It's a real problem as far as scientific analysis is concerned. Because you see, what we know as a scientific fact is that complex specified information, and we won't go into the detail on that now because it's very difficult to describe, but it cannot be generated spontaneously. It cannot originate endogenously, which means from some internal cause, and it cannot organize itself. In other words, complex specified information can never occur by chance. And yet that's what DNA is. It's complex specified information. Yeah, the word intelligence comes from two Latin words. Inter, meaning between, and lego, meaning, well, to choose. So intelligent design signifies that design is inferred precisely because an intelligent cause has done what only an intelligent cause can do. It's made a choice between two or more different things. So what we know about complex specified information is it presupposes intelligence. The trouble is that sits in every cell of your body to the tune of 300 billion units. How did that get there? 350 Bibles worth in every cell. How did that arrive? Who wrote the code language? Who wrote the error correction program? Who wrote the transcribing process? Information presupposes intelligence. I love this slide because I just think it's extraordinarily powerful. Have you ever seen computer code? That's a section of standard computer coding. If you were to see a page of computer coding, what would you assume? You would assume that there was an intelligent coder behind that code coding some program for some purpose for the computer to do some calculation. And by the way, you'd be right. Would you like to see some DNA code? One scientist who's probably the most virulently anti-religious and most fundamentalist dogmatic atheist that exists on the planet today said this. He said the machine code of the genes is uncannily computer-like. Apart from differences in jargon, the pages of a molecular biology journal might be interchanged with those of a computer engineering journal, he says. Quote, Richard Dawkins. And the stunning thing about that observation is this. He would accept without question that that was intelligently coded. And he utterly refuses to believe that that is. That's cognitive bias, not scientific reasoning. Some of you will have heard of the SETI program. You know what SETI stands for? Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. So they've got listening dishes out to listen out into distant space for signs of intelligence somewhere, anywhere. Can we hear it? Come in, please. Speak to us. They've had those massive electronic ears out since the 1960s. What are they listening for, by the way? What do you think they'd be listening for as a sign of intelligence? Answer, some form of code. Morse code? Primary numbers? Anything that is a code that indicates intelligence. And yet those same people that are searching for extraterrestrially intelligent, and by the way, they would claim they found it if they did see a bit of Morse code coming in, will absolutely not see the evidence of DNA code as representing intelligence. It's a problem. And Paul goes on to say in Acts 17, verse 26, he says, the God that made all things, that's given life to all things, that's given the mystery of life in code to all men, has made of one all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth, and hath determined before the times appointed and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. God's actually put the limitations of time on man. It's a problem, you see, because the book of Ecclesiastes says that right at the beginning, God did something interesting, and all the things that he did, he set eternity into the heart of man, that they might seek after God, that they might realize that God has done this, that men should fear him. Tell me, why is it that men search for eternity in a body that cannot be eternal? And the answer is because there's something deep in the mind of man that yearns to break free from the constraints of time. Ecclesiastes says, God put it there. He determined the bounds of the times of all men. But for what purpose? Verse 27 of Acts. That they might seek after him. That they might try and find him. That they might search for God out of all this. Although he says, verse 27, if we did search, we would find that he's not far from any of us, because in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we also are his offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's device. Oh, we see what it says, verse 28, in him we live and move and have our being. Or as the literal Greek means, in him we live and move and are. Oh, there's a problem. A massive problem for the scientist. It's called the challenge of consciousness. See, it's all very well to postulate that spontaneous generation somehow, in some way, was able to take non-living material and suddenly miraculously make it living. That in itself, by the way, is a scientific impossibility. But let's say it had been done. It doesn't answer this range of questions. How is it that man has a sense of purpose? Where does his intelligence come from? Where does the power of conceptual thought arrive? What do you mean to have an embodied self? What about the subject of intention, or information processing, or rationality, or language, or consciousness, or abstract reflection, or meaning, or reason, or awareness? You see, there's a whole range of human realities here that just cannot be explained. Now, you might not be following what I'm saying, but can you just see this table here? Right here, this table? This table is made of matter. If we allowed this table a trillion years of time, will it ever contemplate who it is? Will it ever think about the meaning of its existence? You see, we don't realize how vital it is when we talk about ourself. Who's ourself? We talk about we, us, I, as if somehow that's different to, well, different to who or what? Different to your brain? Is your brain you, or are you something different to the brain? You see, man is endowed with these astonishing capacities of self-awareness and of conceptual thought for which there is no scientific rationale or explanation whatsoever. Unless an intelligent God endowed mankind with all those capacities. They'll never come from a table. Not ever, ever, ever will it come from inanimate material. So here's a summary of this, and I'm sorry about the length of this, but I think it's helpful. Life, consciousness, mind can only come from a source that is living, conscious, and thinking. If we are centers of consciousness and thought who are able to know and love and intend and execute, I cannot see how such centers could come from something that is itself incapable of all these activities. Matter cannot produce conceptions and perceptions. A force field does not plan or think. So at the level of reason and everyday experience, we become immediately aware that the world of living, conscious, thinking beings has to originate in a living source. A mind. That's what Paul says. That's what Paul says. He says that we all come from God in heaven because we are his offspring. And Paul goes on to say, just to wrap up what Acts 17 says, he says, at the times of this ignorance, verse 30, God winked at, but now commands all men everywhere to repent because he's appointed the day. The day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, and that he hath raised him from the dead. God's got a plan. God has an intention to bring everything into account, to finally resolve all that he intended from the beginning to make sure it happens. And it happened, by the way, that whole advancing of his purpose will occur, or did occur, by the dramatic resurrection of his own son from the dead to set in motion a new form of life and living and being that would transcend even the current order of things which he began at the beginning of time. So what have we got in reality? We've got a scientific process that says there is a universe without purpose. That's what science offers us. Here's one of the most, here's Richard Dawkins again, a Darwinian view of life. In a universe of electrons and selfish genes, blind physical forces and genetic replication, some people are going to get hurt, other people are going to get lucky, and you won't find any rhyme or reason in it, nor any justice. The universe that we observe has precisely the properties we should expect if there is, at bottom, no design, no purpose, no evil, no good, nothing but pitiless indifference. That's the world hope that science offers. And it's not what the Bible says. And it's not what the Bible explains. See, the Bible doesn't just give an answer to how everything began, but it gives us a hope as to why it all began. See, God himself transcends time and space and matter and energy. He operates outside all of those things. He's from everlasting, but he has no end, says the book of Psalms. So he's capable of doing all of these things because he stands outside all of the dimensions that constrain the scientific thinking and planning of mankind. And God, in his timelessness, does have an ultimate purpose with what he intends to do upon the earth. Now, because of the constraints of time, I was going to turn these passages up, but I think I'll just put them on the screen because I think we can see them easily enough from here. So Genesis chapter 1 said, remember, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, and he created them male and female, and he said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. He created them so that they could do something. There was an intention behind what God did. And he tells us what that intention is in Isaiah 45. He says, thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it, he hath established that he created it not in vain. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, he says, and there is none else. God had an intention behind his creative power. When he commanded male and female to fill the earth, he wasn't actually commanding them to fill the earth with themselves, funnily enough. He's wanting to populate the earth with himself. I'm the Lord, there's none else. So God's intention is to fill the earth with himself, but in the form of individuals who all think and act like him and who have been endowed with intelligent capacities to be like him. See, science says there's no purpose to the universe. You know one of the strangest things about man? We are purpose-driven creatures. Utterly purpose-driven creatures. From whence comes the driving force of purpose in our lives? Science doesn't offer it. Science says there is no purpose. No purpose at all. God says, oh yes, there is. I created you for a purpose, and I've endowed you even with the concept of purpose. We are teleological creatures, creatures of purpose. Where did that purpose come from in man's life? From a purposeless natural process, or from a purposeful, intelligent creator? Well, here's the purpose. Revelation says, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things. For what purpose? For thy pleasure. They are and were created. From the very beginning was purpose. Not only intelligence, but purpose. And that theme starts in Genesis and ends in Revelation. It's a wonderful purpose because it promises to transform the earth. We've talked about beginnings tonight, so let's come to our final passage and talk about endings, shall we? Because whatever God has begun, he does intend to end. But the end is good. And this is what the 1st of Corinthians chapter 15 says about the end that God had in mind when he intelligently designed all things from the very beginning of time. He began with intelligence and he began with purpose. 1st Corinthians 15 says, verse 24, but the day will come when there shall be the end. And that end is when Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ, who's the he of that verse, shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power, for he must reign till he's put all enemies under his feet. And the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death itself. So man's yearning for eternity will be fulfilled when death is destroyed. For God has put, verse 27, all things under the feet of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. But when he saith all things are put under him, It is manifest that he is accepted, which did put all things under him, that is God. And when all things shall be subdued under him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him. For what purpose? For what intention? That God may be all in all. See, that's the purpose for which everything began at the beginning of time. That when God's end comes, he will have enthroned himself on the earth so totally and so utterly and so completely in a glorified multitude of everlasting, eternal, immortal creatures, all like him, that God will be all and in all. And that was a very intelligent design that he had right from the beginning. The Bible offers us a hope as well as an intelligible explanation of the origin of life, so much more satisfying than the pitiless indifference of purposeless science. In the words of a hymn, the one with which we shall close, which perhaps puts it this way, of thy great unbounded power, to thee the praise we give, infinitely great, more than heart can e'er conceive. When thou wilt to work proceed, thy purpose firm, none can withstand, frustrate thy determined deed, or stay thy mighty hand.